Hello friends, this is a video on the novelists of the Romantic period. Can you guess who they are? Yeah, Walter Scott, very important, Jane Austen, Maria Edgeworth. Let's take a look at them. This is Walter Scott. There has already been a video on Walter Scott, I think, but that was Walter Scott as a poet. Or did I talk about him? I don't remember. Anyway, Walter Scott was a very important writer of the Romantic period, early Romantic, from the early Romantic till the late Romantic period. He was born in 1771, in between Coleridge and Wordsworth. Wordsworth, 1770, Walter Scott, 1771, and Coleridge, 1772. And he lived up to the year 1832. What is the importance of this year? The Great Reform Act. Walter Scott was Scottish. He was a poet, novelist, primarily a poet. Then in his middle age, he began to anonymously write novels. And then he was also an editor and critic. Scott was born in the magnificent city of Edinburgh. It is a city full of ancient buildings from the colonial period, buildings that they built in the manner of Greek buildings. And Scott was the ninth of 12 children. Oh my God, his parents had 12 children. And poor Scott, even in his childhood, he had troubles. He was lamed by infantile paralysis. He got the paralysis that children get, infantile paralysis. But he never let that disorder or disease, disability, stop him from working. He never let this make him an invalid. He was a very prolific worker. He was over 6 feet tall. It must have been really difficult because of he was lame and he was so tall also. And he was a formidable personality. Scott was educated at Edinburgh High School and at Edinburgh University, where his study was on law. A lot of important people, educated people at that time, you can see, are educated in law, because it was the subject that people took up for a public career, a public profession, public life. And Scott had an astonishing memory that is very important for him as a writer, because his novels and his poems are full of stories. They are full of stories. He read voraciously ancient stories, oral stories that were written down. He read voraciously ballads, fairy tales, and his books are full of all these elements. Chivalric romances, exotic tales of distant places. In 1795, the year in which Wordsworth met Coleridge, if you remember, Scott got married and he became a deputy sheriff and was about to enter a literary life. The next year, 1796, at the age of 25, he began to professionally translate works from German. In 1796, his adaptation of ballads by Gottfried August Berger appeared anonymously. His adaptation was published by Berger. In 1799, he made the first English translation of Goethe's play, Gods of the Iron Hand. That is a play with Shakespearean overtones, if you remember. In 1801, Scott contributed translations to the Gothic novelist Matthew Gregory Lewis's collection, Tales of Wonder. What happened was, Matthew Gregory Lewis was translating a book. He was bringing out a book of translations, and Scott contributed his translations of Gothic stories to it. Sorry. In 1802-3 period, he brought out The Minstrelsy of the Scottish Ballads. That is his first collection of ballads in 3 volumes. The Minstrelsy of the Scottish Border, his first collection. Scott's metrical version of the medieval romance, Sir Tristram, appeared in 1804. And Scott's poetic writing so far was dominated by a blend of Gothic Germanic sorcery and antiquarian enthusiasm. What do you mean by that? Gothic Germanic sorcery, tales of Gothic Germanic magic and witchcraft, and antiquarian enthusiasm. He showed a lot of enthusiasm for ancient tales. In 1805, that was the year in which Prelude was published in 13 cantos, and 1805 was the year in which Scott's The Lay of the Last Minstrel was published. It's an old border story. And that is when he really became famous. His name became well known, and he became extremely famous at this time. There was no looking back. Only later, Byron equaled that fame. In the same year, Scott entered into a secret partnership with James Ballantyne, his friend in the publishing industry. Later, until the company collapsed in 1813, he was the half-owner of the company, James Ballantyne. In 1805, a number of longer poems were published, including Marmion. Marmion, 1808. It was considered his masterpiece in poetry. Marmion has an antiquarian theme, and it contains the poem Lochinvar. The Lady of the Lake, The Vision of Don Roderick, Rockby and the Bridal of Trier Main. These are other important poems. There were other shorter poems written during this period, but some of Scott's best verses are found in his novels, because in those days, novels are interspersed with poetry. In between novels in the 18th century, you find a lot of poems also. First, let us take a look at Scott's poetry. Scott made picturesque descriptions, effective use of wild scenery, vigorous tone. He always wrote in a vigorous tone. Very energetic man he was. Writing too many incidents and details, writing too many books also. Very prolific. And he portrayed physical actions rather simply without analysis. He did not bring in a lot of analysis into his works. Hey, for that, Scott was criticized for his superficial treatment. He did not analyze his characters and situations very much, so he was criticized for superficial treatment. Scott did write a lot, and he was very famous, but he lacks greater poetic virtues. One thing I should tell you, he lacks greater poetic virtues, such as reflection, melody, sympathy, sense of humor. He revived and gave a new zest to romantic methods. Scott revived romantic methods in poetry, and he gave a new zest to romantic methods. What are the romantic methods? Nature, beautiful picturesque descriptions, history, right, mythology, medieval elements. Now, prodigious output of prose. Oh my God, apart from writing a great deal of poetry, he wrote a prolific, prodigious output of prose also. During these years, Scott also produced a tremendous volume of prose work and also editorial work. That means he edited books, much of it relating to criticism, antiquarianism, and history. This includes an edition of Dryden with biographical material. He edited Dryden's works and added some biographical essays also, and published Dryden's works. Numerous book reviews came. For the Whig Edinburgh Review. Edinburgh Review, quarterly review, remember? Whig. Edinburgh Review. Blackwood's Magazine and Quarterly Review are Tory Magazine. Oh my God, stupid me. Hey, tricked you. Did you notice? Edinburgh Review, if you remember from the Romantic Revival video, Edinburgh Review was Whig, and it attacked Wordsworth and Coleridge in their conservative years. It was a Whig magazine, then edited by Francis Jeffrey. In 1809, Scott took a prominent role in establishing the Tory magazine Quarterly Review, where, if you remember, his son-in-law, John Gibson Lockhart, was an important contributor and editor. John Gibson Lockhart was Scott's son-in-law, and also he was Scott's biographer. So in 1809, he moved away from Whig Edinburgh Review, where he was publishing book reviews, and he played a prominent role in founding the Tory Quarterly Review, where his son-in-law, John Gibson Lockhart, was an editor. Until 1811, Scott was fairly prosperous. He had money, he was prospering, well-to-do. extended his old cottage and named it Abbotsford. That is his beloved house. Very famous. Scott's Abbotsford. Ballantyne Publishing Company. Remember, he was collaborating with his friend James Ballantyne. Ballantyne Publishing Company collapsed in 1813. And the company was bought by Archibald Constable and Co., who were Scott's publishers until 1826. Scott was reduced from impending bankruptcy by his patron, the Duke of Buccleuch. I don't know how to pronounce it. If you go online, dear Kalyani, you can get pronunciation for anything. Did you understand? So anybody who doesn't want to make a mistake in pronunciation, go online. Buccleuch. Buccleuch. Hey, you should never take for granted. Don't go with your wrong pronunciation. Immediately, Buccleuch. I looked up in my phone. Buccleuch. So Scott is rescued from impending bankruptcy. Even though he had money before this, now he's going bankrupt and his patron is the Duke of Buccleuch. Scott's financial conditions improved when Scott embarked on a career as a novelist. He began making money as a novelist, but he did not have the courage to put down his name at the beginning. His earliest novels all came anonymously because already he was bankrupt and taking loans from other people. Now he did not want to bother them with novels. So he embarked on a career as a novelist, began to make money, inherited his brother's estate in 1816, headed a team which rediscovered the lost crown jewels of Scotland. Oh my God. He was part of the team that discovered the lost crown jewels of Scotland, and he was made a baron as a reward. Scott's highly acclaimed novel Waverley was published anonymously by Constable in 1814. It was subtitled 'Tis 60 Years Since, and it was regarded as the first historical novel. It was set against the Jacobite Rebellion of 1745, and it portrayed peasant characters sympathetically. So, Waverley, the now very famous novel, at first came anonymously. It was subtitled 'Tis 60 Years Since, regarded as the first historical novel set against the Jacobite Rebellion of 1745. If you remember, King James and his followers were leading rebellions against the English monarchs. Since the Glorious Revolution, they were leading fights against the monarchs, British monarchs. And this led to two major Jacobite rebellions in 1715 and 1745. There were two major Jacobite rebellions in 1715 and 1745. Scott set his Waverley against the Jacobite rebellion of 1745. And here he portrayed peasant characters sympathetically. Clear? A series of novels on similar themes, such as Waverley, came after this. And they together came to be called Waverley novels. He did not put his name in any of these novels. They were generally called by the author of Waverley. All these novels were called by the author of Waverley because Waverley was the most famous. And these Waverley novels are Guy Mannering, The Antiquary, Rob Roy, The Bride of Lammermoor, The Monastery and the Abbot. Hey, if they ask you which of the following is not a novel by Scott, you should be able to answer. That's why I'm giving you this. The Pirate, The Talisman, The Woodstock. Now, the Woodstock, yeah? Woodstock. Now, Ivanhoe is his best known novel, came in 1820. I have given a separate video on Ivanhoe, if you remember. It is set in the time of Richard I or Richard the Lionheart in the 12th century. That is the Plantagenet rule. The story is one of the remaining Saxon families at the time when English nobility was predominantly Norman. Cedric the Saxon and Ivanhoe, Wilfred of Ivanhoe. This novel revived medievalism in English literature. And the legendary Robin Hood, initially under the name Locksley, appears as one of the characters with his merry men. Kenilworth came the next year, 1821. It's a romance set in Elizabethan England in the year 1575. And it's a tragedy. It centers on the secret marriage of the ambitious nobleman, Robert Dudley. He was the first Earl of Leicester. He secretly marries Amy of Robsart. And then what happens? The queen discovers the truth, to the shame of the earl, because the earl was not supposed to marry without the queen's knowledge. And he did it. Now the disclosure comes too late. The queen is going to forgive him, but too late, because Amy has been murdered by their steward, Varney. He's the villain. Both Ivanhoe and Kenilworth are prescribed in various universities. Ivanhoe, there is an opera based on Ivanhoe. In the Victorian period, there was an opera made on based on Ivanhoe. The women characters are Rebecca and Rowena. Ivanhoe finally marries Rowena. Rebecca and Rowena is a book written by Thackeray. Beyond writing novels, Scott was throughout these years again busy with editions, antiquarian studies, literary criticism. An edition of Jonathan Swift's works came in 1814 along with biographical data. Oh my God, this was followed by a tremendous output of writings. Prolific man he was, prolific writer, mostly historical in nature. The hard work he engaged in as a writer, lawyer, and as a social figure, took a heavy toll on his health. By 1826, the failure of his publisher, Archibald Constable & Co., remember? Constable was the publisher, led him to financial crisis once again. He set to work at an even more furious pace, producing more works, including The Life of Napoleon. Oh, my grandmother used to tell me one joke. മുത്യമേ മുത്യമേ നിങ്ങളെന്താ ഓടണേ നടക്കാൻ വയ്യാഞ്ഞിട്ട മോനെ ഇൻ ഇംഗ്ലീഷ് ഇറ്റ് മീൻസ് ഓൾഡ് വുമൺ വൈ ആർ യു റണ്ണിങ് ഇറ്റ്സ് ബിക്കോസ് ഐ കാൻ്റ് വാക്ക് സ്കോട്ട് ഇസ് ലൈക്ക് ദാറ്റ് when he became seriously ill, he began writing even more at an even more furious pace. Can you believe that? Scott, why are you writing at a furious pace? It is because I am ill and I can't write. So in his illness, he wrote The Life of Napoleon. In 1827, he finally admitted to the authorship of the Waverley novels at a public dinner. At a public dinner, he announced, "I am the author of Waverley." He announced his name. The next year, he started a series called Tales of a Grandfather to his grandson. Not only did he tell his grandson stories, he even wrote them down. And this grandson was the son of John Gibson Lockhart, his son-in-law, Scott's future biographer. In 1831, following a stroke, oh my God, Scott went to Italy in an attempt to revive his health, but returned to his beloved Abbotsford and died the next year in September. Oh, Scott is dead. Scott's reputation was tremendous. His Scottish novels, particularly Waverley and Rob Roy, did much to rescue that country from the low esteem it had acquired. Scotland had a low esteem in those days. People made fun of Scotland. Especially after the 1745 rebellion, people looked upon Scottish people as, English people looked upon Scottish people as terrorists. But Walter Scott's novels rescued Scotland from its ignominy and gave it a better reputation once again. The descriptions of the landscape and ruins with which his books abound. His books are full of descriptions of landscape and ruins that helped to shape Romanticism. Above all, his use of history confirmed the taste for medievalism, which lasted throughout the 19th century. And the conduct of the historical figures served as the model of the chivalric code by which Victorian gentlemen attempted to live. The conduct of the historical figures in his novels served as the model of the chivalric code by which Victorian gentlemen attempted to live. The gentlemen of the Victorian period tried to live like that. Scott was one of the first writers in England to enjoy an international reputation. Yet today, Scott is a comparatively neglected writer. When I posted Ivanhoe video, one of my students who has been following all my videos in YouTube and Udemy, who has been listening and getting transformed completely by the videos. She is doing a lot of work. You should also listen to the videos, do extra research, do a lot of work like that. You know what she said? Ivanhoe is such a boring text. But ma'am, you made it interesting. Ivanhoe is such a boring text. Things all the contemporary readers. Today, that is why Scott is a comparatively neglected writer. The immense bulk of his writing and the sheer length of his individual works. Oh my God, such big works. The bulk of his writing, the length of his works is intimidating. You get scared. His characters are dismissed as artificial and his plots are stilted and melodramatic. His fascination with history can appear a mere fancy. It looks like just a fancy when he writes history today. But Scott had a lot of imitators and contemporaries among his contemporaries. William H. Ainsworth, George James, and our famous Thomas Love Peacock. William H. Ainsworth and George James, we don't know. Their novels covered many periods of English history. Both of them wrote a lot of novels. But Thomas Love Peacock, his novels are important. Headlong Hall, Melin Court, Nightmare Abbey. Thomas Love Peacock wrote ironical, satirical attacks on romanticism in the four ages of poetry. Iron, gold, silver, and brass. These are the four ages of poetry, according to him. His age is called Age of Brass and Second Childhood. Age of Brass and Second Childhood. That is what he calls Romantic Age. Don't worry. P.B. Shelley wrote a reply in a defense of poetry. P.B. Shelley's A Defense of Poetry is a reply to the four ages of poetry. Now, the next writer is Jane Austen, 1775. Hey, that was the year in which Charles Lamb was born. Jane Austen lived from 1775 to 1817. Oh, she died so young. Jane Austen was born in Steventon in Hampshire. Hey, I have been to Jane Austen Birthplace Museum. There are 2-3 museums in England for Jane Austen. In Chawton also there is a museum. I've been there too. Jane Austen was born in Steventon in Hampshire, where her father, who was also her tutor, was a clergyman. On his retirement in 1801, the family moved to Bath, a city that frequently appears in her fiction. Bath is a place where also there is a museum. The family returned to Hampshire after their father's death. With her mother and sister, she had only one sister, Cassandra. Jane Austen first lived in Southampton and then Chawton, remaining there until she died. Her life was conspicuous for its lack of events and for the strength of her family ties, most importantly, with her sister, Cassandra. She died in Winchester at the age of 41. Jane Austen died in Winchester at the age of 41. Now, this is the only existing portrait of Jane Austen from her lifetime. It was made by her nephew, J.E. Austen Leigh. J.E. Austen Leigh was Jane Austen's nephew. And this is the only likeness of her that we have from these times. Okay. So, I'm going to do one trick from this today's video onwards. There are a number of people who are regularly watching these videos. I'm going to call out their names. So, they will be shocked. Oh my God. She said my name. Did you hear that? Humaira Wani from Kashmir. Humaira Wani. I was saying that this is Jane Austen's only likeness from her own lifetime. And this is Jane Austen House at Chawton. Jane Austen's house at Chawton. Shweta Garg. Shweta, you should one day go to this house. This is a museum, I told you. This is Jane Austen Museum. When I went there, it was springtime and there were so many flowers everywhere. So many flowers. And there is a yew tree here. I think this is that yew tree. Love and Friendship was a burlesque of Richardson. Burlesque based on Richardson. A burlesque based on Richardson that our Jane Austen wrote when she was only 15 years old. When she was only 15 years old, she wrote one novel. And her early novels of the 1790s, that is Sense and Sensibility, her first published novel. Before that, she wrote Northanger Abbey. After Sense and Sensibility, she wrote Pride and Prejudice. These novels caricature the sentimentality or excessive sensibility of the late 18th century. Sentimentality and excessive sensibility of the late 18th century are made fun of in the early novels of Jane Austen, such as Northanger Abbey, then Sense and Sensibility, Pride and Prejudice, etc. Robbie Roy, did you hear that? She attacked sensibility of the 18th century. There was, in the 18th century, Robbie, a literature of sensibility. And this literature of sensibility includes Samuel Richardson's Pamela, etc., which are full of sensibility and sentimentality. Jane Austen caricatured it. Okay? Now, Northanger Abbey, her first written novel, it was published only posthumously in 1818, however, satirizes the ridiculous in contemporary taste. In contemporary taste, people were after, in contemporary society, people were after Gothic romances. People gave a lot of importance to Gothic romances. They read a lot of Gothic romances. At that time, Jane Austen is satirizing this ridiculous interest in Gothic romances in Northanger Abbey. She satirizes her heroine, Catherine Morland's interest in Gothic fiction. Her next novel, Jaspal Singh, are you listening to me? Her next novel is Sense and Sensibility after Northanger Abbey, the second written novel. It was earlier titled Eleanor and Marianne. Don't worry, I will go into details of all these novels. Sense and Sensibility was probably written in 1797-98 period, but not published until 1811. Jane Austen's first novel to be published was Sense and Sensibility in 1811. Next came Pride and Prejudice. That is her most famous novel, Pride and Prejudice. And it has the same high spirits as its predecessors. Shraddha Pandey, are you listening to my videos these days? I hope you are. Pride and Prejudice, I'm talking about. It had the same high spirits as its predecessors. And it was the first of her mature works. The original title of Pride and Prejudice is First Impressions. It was first begun as an epistolary novel. There are so many letters in Pride and Prejudice now also. And it was first written as an epistolary novel. And the opening line is very famous, as you know. It's a truth universally acknowledged that a single man in possession of a good fortune must be in want of a wife. After this age, it's always better to remember the order of composition of everybody's novels, especially people like Jane Austen, very famous authors. You should remember the order of composition of the novels, okay? Because they ask chronology questions in exams. So do that. Divya Kanwar, second novel after Pride, the next novel after Pride and Prejudice was Mansfield Park, which was followed by Emma. Divya, first, she wrote, remember, Northanger Abbey. Then Sense and Sensibility, then Pride and Prejudice, then Mansfield Park, then Emma. The last novel to be published, to be written was Persuasion. And Persuasion was published along with her first written novel, that is Northanger Abbey. So, Habib Ali, you are not listening to my videos these days, I think. Please do listen, because I'm uploading more and more, and as you wanted, I will upload complete videos, okay? Complete videos on authors, okay? Right. So Northanger Abbey and Persuasion, Habib, were published together posthumously after her death in 1818. Remember, she died in which year, Habib? 1817. Yeah. Now, let us talk about Pride and Prejudice first. It is not in chronological order. After Pride and Prejudice, I'll talk about Sense and Sensibility, I think. It's okay, though. Charles Bingley, a single man. He is an unmarried man, and he is very rich. He moves to Netherfield Estate. Charles Bingley is coming to Netherfield Estate. And Mrs. Bennett, their neighbor in their neighboring house, Longbourn, is thrilled. And she hopes to marry one of her five daughters to him. She has five daughters. Oh, my God. And she wants at least one of them to be married quickly. So she's thrilled thinking that Charles will marry one of her daughters. The Bennett daughters meet Bingley at a ball and are impressed. They are less impressed by Bingley's proud friend, Fitzwilliam Darcy. Bingley has two sisters. One is married, one is not. And he has a friend, Darcy. Darcy is also a rich man like Bingley. And Darcy is a little proud. He is too proud and he doesn't want to mingle with the locals of that town. So they are less impressed by Darcy. Darcy is a land-owning aristocrat who is too proud to speak to any of the locals. And he doesn't dance with Elizabeth also. She, Elizabeth Bennett, the second sister, among the Bennett sisters, she overhears Darcy refusing to dance with her. She's not handsome enough to tempt me, Darcy says. One of these days, I'll put a video on Pride and Prejudice in YouTube and Udemy. So you can listen to the detailed overview of this text. Okay. Diksha Kajal, I hope you are listening. Now, Diksha, what happens now? Let us see, Diksha. Bingley and the oldest Bennett daughter, Jane, fall in love. Bingley falls in love with the oldest Bennett daughter, that is Jane. And she is very beautiful. But Elizabeth is not so beautiful, but she is more intelligent. Did you understand? Now, the relationship is opposed by Bingley's sisters. Bingley's sisters do not approve of Jane because Mrs. Bennett doesn't have a very high class background. She is little low class. Mr. Bennett had married beneath his class. That is why. So the Bingley sisters do not want their brother to marry Jane. And incidentally, that love affair is not supported by Darcy either. Darcy thinks that Jane is indifferent to Bingley, that she doesn't like Bingley. So he also is against that match. Meanwhile, Darcy, at first, even though he didn't like Elizabeth, he becomes attracted to Elizabeth's wit and expressive eyes. He's a straightforward man. When he's proud, he shows it. And when he realizes that Elizabeth is a very intelligent girl, he appreciates that. He gets attracted to Elizabeth's wit and expressive eyes. And Caroline Bingley is jealous. Elizabeth, however, is prejudiced against Darcy. Elizabeth despises Darcy and is instead stupidly attracted to George Wickham, a handsome military officer, but he's a treacherous fellow actually. Wickham tells Elizabeth that Darcy, he's lying, okay? I'll tell you the truth. Venkat, M. Venkat, remember you watched my cultural studies video? Yeah, now, Venkat, listen, Darcy is proud, but actually he's a good man. And Elizabeth is prejudiced against him, Venkat. And you know what? She foolishly falls in love with Wickham. And Wickham is a liar and a treacherous fellow. Wickham tells Elizabeth, lies. It is lies. That Darcy had selfishly deprived him of a living that Darcy's father had offered him. Elizabeth is even more prejudiced to Darcy now. The Bennets are visited by Mr. Bennett's cousin, William Collins. Mr. Bennett's cousin, William Collins, is a clergyman who will inherit Mr. Bennett's estate because of a legal stricture. You know, in those days, there was a very funny rule. Even if a couple had five daughters, the property will go to somebody else because only a man can inherit property. Women cannot inherit. Either there should be a son or there should be one married daughter. Then the son-in-law will inherit. So these daughters are not married. That is why Mrs. Bennett is eager to get one of them married. And Mr. Collins is going to inherit it, one relative. And Mr. Collins has been asked by his patroness, Krishnapriya. Who is the patroness? Venkat, Krishnapriya, Humaira, Anybody? Ah, the patroness is Lady Catherine de Bourgh. Mr. Collins has been asked by his patroness, Lady Catherine de Bourgh, to marry. And he proposes to Elizabeth. But he's stunned and offended when she refuses him. Elizabeth doesn't like him. He is a fool. And he is shocked. How can you reject me? I'm such an eligible bachelor, he thinks. Elizabeth rejects him and he is shocked. In that shock, he goes and proposes to Elizabeth's friend, Charlotte Lucas. Charlotte is the daughter of a nearby aristocrat, Lucas, Sir Lucas. And Charlotte wants to just marry for security rather than love. So she immediately accepts the proposal. Divya Ajay, you know what she did? Charlotte accepts Mr. Collins's proposal and they get married and they go and start living in Kent. Do you know who else lives in Kent, Divya? Catherine de Bourgh lives in Kent as well as our Darcy. He lives in an estate called Pemberley. Divya, listen. Now, Jane is dismayed to find that Bingley and family have unexpectedly left for London. Suddenly, Charles Bingley with his family leaves for London. And she is shocked because she thinks Charles is leaving her. Carolyn Bingley also writes to Jane that they do not intend to return. And she predicts a match between Bingley and Darcy's sister Georgiana. Oh, Carolyn Bingley is being very cruel to Jane. She is suggesting to Jane that there won't be any marriage between Jane and our... Robbie? There won't be any marriage between Jane and Charles Bingley. So Elizabeth suspects that Bingley's sisters and Darcy are trying to keep him from Jane. Elizabeth suspects that these people, Elizabeth's sisters and Mrs. Hurst and Carolyn Bingley, they are the sisters. They are trying to keep Darcy from Jane. Elizabeth visits Charlotte at her new home in Huntsford in Kent. There she meets Mr. Collins's patroness and Darcy's aunt, Lady Catherine de Bourgh. She's an overbearing woman who meddles in other people's affairs. And she looks down upon Elizabeth and insults her. And she calls Elizabeth obstinate, headstrong girl. Elizabeth is not scared of her. She stands up against her, against Lady Catherine, and very strongly. And she doesn't get scared by Lady Catherine. While Elizabeth is in Kent, remember Prajwal Dwivedi? Elizabeth went to Kent with his uncle and aunt, remember? So she's in Kent now. That is where she met Lady Catherine de Bourgh Prajwal. Darcy at this time visits his aunt with his cousin, Colonel Fitzwilliam. Everybody in their family is called Colonel, I think. Darcy is visiting his aunt with his cousin, Colonel Fitzwilliam. One day he surprises Elizabeth by proposing to her. Still repelled by his pride and her prejudice, Elizabeth refuses him. The next day, Darcy gives a letter. Darcy gives a letter explaining his role in influencing Bingley away from Jane. Darcy explains that he did not want to, actually cause any trouble. He thought that Jane did not love Bingley. And he also tells the truth about Wickham. Wickham is lying. What Wickham has told her is not the truth. The letter reveals that Darcy, though proud, is innocent of wrongdoing. Back home, Elizabeth goes on a trip with her aunt and uncle to Derbyshire County, where they visit Darcy's estate of Pemberley. They think that Darcy won't be there, but Darcy was there. There they meet Darcy unexpectedly, and all are surprised at how graciously he treats them. He doesn't show any ill feeling, and he's very polite, and he's a very epitome of hospitality. Elizabeth begins to feel love for him. Oh, he's a wonderful man. But how can she go back on her word? Elizabeth hears from Jane at that time, a very upsetting letter Jane sends Elizabeth. I told you this novel is full of letters. What is there in that letter? Lydia has eloped with Wickham. Oh my God, Elizabeth was almost in love with Wickham, and now Lydia, her stupid younger sister, who was always along with Kitty, both Kitty and Lydia were after the soldiers who had camped at Brighton. And now Lydia has eloped with Wickham, causing dishonor to the family. Elizabeth fears that the Bennet family is permanently disgraced. Oh, what a tragedy. What will they do now? When Lydia is found, however, she and Wickham marry. Not naturally. It was after the wedding that Elizabeth discovers that Darcy was instrumental in orchestrating the marriage, in getting Wickham to agree to marry Lydia. It was Darcy who was instrumental. Thereby, he saved the reputation of the other Bennet daughters. That was a big revelation. Bingley now returns to Netherfield and asks Jane to marry him. Jane, of course, accepts. And meanwhile, Lady Catherine de Bourgh arrives on hearing a rumor that Darcy and Elizabeth are engaged. Lady Catherine de Bourgh warns Elizabeth not to accept any proposal from Darcy. But Elizabeth refuses, of course. She is not scared of Lady Catherine. Lady Catherine complains to Darcy about Elizabeth's impertinence, which gives Darcy hope that Elizabeth has had a change of heart. Lady Catherine foolishly goes and complains to Darcy, and Darcy now has hope that Elizabeth has a change of heart. He proposes again, and Elizabeth happily accepts. Now, this is a picture from a 1995 BBC adaptation. This is 2005. Emma is the next novel we are discussing here. 20-year-old Emma Woodhouse of the village of Highbury has decided never to marry. But she imagines herself to be naturally gifted in matchmaking. She doesn't have a realistic understanding of herself. She thinks in a very mature manner that she is naturally gifted in matchmaking. Her only friend and critic is her neighbor, George Knightley. Now, she happened to be the matchmaker accidentally in the marriage between her governess and Mr. Weston, a village widower. She got into the idea that she is a matchmaker because she led to the marriage between, she was instrumental in getting these two people married. And against the advice of Knightley, Emma set out to match her friend Harriet Smith with one Mr. Elton, the village vicar. Her friend Harriet Smith, a girl of unknown parentage, poor girl. She at that time had a proposal from a well-to-do farmer, Robert Martin. Emma made her reject that proposal and gave Harriet hope that Mr. Elton, the village vicar, will marry her. So Harriet rejects the proposal of Robert Martin, a well-to-do farmer whom Harriet clearly liked. It would have been a good marriage. But Emma's plan is spoiled when Mr. Elton instead proposes to Emma. Emma doesn't want to get married. Emma cannot get Mr. Elton to marry Harriet either now. Offended by Emma's refusal, Elton marries a newly rich girl in Bath, at which Harriet considers herself heartbroken. Harriet is heartbroken by this. At this time, Frank Churchill, who is Mr. Weston's son, has been raised by his aunt and uncle in London. Frank Churchill is Mr. Weston's son. Mr. Weston is the man who married the governess. So Frank Churchill, who had been raised by his aunt and uncle in London, now arrives in Highbury. Knightley distrusts Frank. Knightley does not like Frank Churchill, but Emma flirts with him and almost falls in love with him. Another person also arrives in Highbury at this time, the beautiful and orphaned Jane Fairfax. She is the niece of a poor woman, Miss Bates, whom Emma envies. Despite Knightley's warnings, Emma tries to fix the match between Harriet and Frank, only to know that Frank is engaged to Jane. Harriet reveals that she is in love with Knightley, At which Emma is dismayed because she herself is in love with him. Harriet reveals that she is in love with Knightley. Knightley now proposes to Emma. And Harriet is comforted by a second proposal from Robert Martin. Luckily, Robert Martin again proposes, which she accepts. The novel ends with the double wedding of Emma and Knightley and Harriet and Robert Martin. Now, this is a poster of a 1996 film. Sense and Sensibility is the first published work of Jane Austen. It was published under the pseudonym A Lady. The story is about the romantic attachments, heartbreaks and marriages of the sisters Eleanor and Marianne Dashwood, representing sense and sensibility respectively. Eleanor is sense, Marianne is sensibility. Look at a scene from a 1995 movie directed by Ang Lee. Then I'm not going into the details of the novel. Mansfield Park. Mansfield Park has a story of the virtuous protagonist Fanny Price. She is a Cinderella brought up by her rich uncle Sir Thomas Bertram, who has plantations in Antigua. This aspect of having slaves and plantations in Antigua has been discussed by Edward Said in Culture and Imperialism. He has discussed Mansfield Park. Fanny's virtuous love for her cousin Edmund wins over the immoral romantic entanglements of the other characters, the other young characters in the novel. Henry Crawford, his sister Mary Crawford, Maria and Julia, the daughters of Bertram, they're all immoral. And Fanny and her cousin Edmund are the only virtuous people. The characters rehearse a play, which is Elizabeth Inchbald's play, Lover's Vows. It has the theme of adultery. That is an important happening in the novel. When Uncle Bertram is not at home, he is in Antigua. Maria, Julia, Henry and Mary all rehearse the play, the immoral play, Lover's Vows, on the theme of adultery. It is considered scandalous. Now, Persuasion. Please look up these novels in more detail. I will also post detailed summaries of the novels presently. Persuasion was published along with Northanger Abbey posthumously, as you know. Both novels are partly set against the superficial social life of Bath. And Persuasion contains biting satire. Anne Elliot of Kellynch Hall had been engaged to the naval officer Frederick Wentworth. But he, that was 8 years ago, 8 years before the novel begins. But she had been persuaded to break off the engagement due to the pressures of the family. Because Frederick Wentworth was not very rich, her mother's friend and other sisters, etc., take initiative to break off her engagement with Frederick Wentworth. Because the family is obsessed with people of rank and wealth. Later, 8 years later, she meets her former love. He is now a rich man and Anne Elliot's family is now poor. How they meet is when Anne Elliot's house, Kellynch Hall, is leased out by Wentworth's sister and brother-in-law. Amidst confusions, the lovers are reunited. That is the story. Now, Northanger Abbey, the first novel. 17-year-old Catherine Morland is excessively fond of reading Gothic novels, especially Anne Radcliffe's The Mysteries of Udolpho. She accompanies her wealthy neighbors, the Allens, to Bath, where they partake in balls and other social delights. She makes friends. Her friends are the flirtatious Isabella Thorpe and her rough-mannered brother John Thorpe. John Thorpe pursues Catherine, but Catherine falls in love with Henry Tilney, the brother of Eleanor Tilney. I hope you're getting it. So Catherine visits Tilney's estate, Northanger Abbey, which she expects to be exotic and frightening, like in Gothic novels. She is too much influenced by Gothic novels. And she thinks the castle should be frightening and General Tilney must be a murderer. General Tilney at this time finds out from a vengeful John Thorpe. John Thorpe is angry with Catherine. That Catherine is not wealthy. General Tilney finds out. And he sends her away from Northanger Abbey. Henry breaks with his father and proposes to Catherine against his father's wishes. And Catherine delightedly accepts. The father later agrees to the marriage. That is the story of Northanger Abbey. More novels are there. Lady Susan, an epistolary novel. The Watsons, which was published after they appeared. These two novels were published after they appeared in the second edition of J.E. Austen Leigh. That is the nephew, remember. His memoir of Jane Austen. There is also a fragment of a novel called Sanditon, on which she was working in the last months of her life. It was first published only in 1925. Now, features of Jane Austen's novels. Jane Austen always portrays small groups of people in a limited environment. She highlights social hypocrisy through irony and employs domestic realism. Her characters are middle class and provincial. Their major preoccupation is with courtship and marriage. The apparently trivial incidents of everyday lives are molded into comedy of manners in this novel. And they contain elements of fairy tales. Austen's heroines undergo a process of education and self-realization. Delicate economy, subtle irony, underlying moral commentary is there. And Austen writes in a smooth, unobtrusive style, avoiding anything unusual, startling, loud, or garish. Smooth, unobtrusive style. There is nothing that is loud, garish, or startling. Jane Austen parodied the sentimental novel. She perfected the 18th century technique of free indirect speech, in which the voices of the characters blend with that of the narrator. There is more emphasis on dialogues than on scenic descriptions. And there are many allusions to contemporary fiction. Walter Scott was a great admirer of Jane Austen. He wrote of that exquisite touch which renders ordinary, commonplace things and characters interesting. Charlotte Bronte and Elizabeth Barrett Browning critiqued her. D.W. Harding, in a major essay, talked about Austen's satire that is more astringent than delicate. Austen is a social critic in search of unobtrusive spiritual survival. D.W. Harding's essay is called Regulated Hatred. Austen's novels are the subject of intense scholarly study. There is even a Jane Austen cult that has emerged in the 1940s after D.W. Harding's essay. Austen's novels, like those of many Victorian writers, employed domestic realism. From the beginning of the 19th century till the end of the 19th century, you can see elements of domestic realism in English literature. Her plots focus on a heroine who embodies one of two types. Either the women will be angelic or there will be practical women. Angelic women, practical women, two extremes. They sometimes exist in the same work. Such a heroine is contrasted with the passive woman. The passive woman is incompetent, cowardly, ignorant. And often the heroine's mother, like Mrs. Bennet, is this type. Then there is also the ballet, who suffers from a defective education. Isabella Thorpe is an example. The heroine struggles for self-mastery, learning the pain of conquering her own passions. She has to struggle with self-mastery. The heroine learns to balance the society's demands for self-denial. The society will want her to deny her self-denial. The society will want her to engage in self-denial. This is conflicting with her own desire for autonomy, a struggle often addressed in terms of religion. For example, Jane Eyre by Charlotte Bronte. The heroine suffers at the hands of abusers of power before establishing a network of surrogate kin, like in Tess of the D'Urbervilles or Jane Eyre. The plots repeatedly identify immersion in feeling as one of the great temptations and dangers for a developing woman. They show that feeling must be controlled. The heroines thus undergo a full education within which to realize feminine obligations. The heroines undergo a process of education. The tales of domestic realism generally end with marriage. And marriage will be one of two kinds. One, reforming the bad or wild male. That is one kind of marriage. Elements of it is there in Pride and Prejudice also. And marrying the solid male who already meets her qualifications. That is like in Emma. The novels may use a language of tears that evokes sympathy from the readers. Class is an important issue in domestic realism, as the ideal family or heroine is poised between a lower class family exemplifying poverty and domestic disorganization. The heroine is poised between lower class family, like in Northanger Abbey, and upper class characters exemplifying an idle, frivolous existence. Next, we have to talk about Maria Edgeworth, 1768 to 1849. Prolific Irish writer, she wrote short stories for children. Some of her works are about education, modifying Rousseau's ideas. Walter Scott admired her work. The best of her novels celebrate Irish culture, and they show the Irish as equal to the English. Castle Rackrent, The Absentee, Ormond are examples. Other novels are Belinda, Harrington, in Absentee, there was an anti-Semitic remark which she makes up for in Harrington. She's not a very major writer, but Scott admired her work. This is Maria Edgeworth. Edgeworth's works had overmastering didacticism, except in Castle Rackrent, oversimplification of life and character. Especially the Irish tales are level-headed. They are better. And she wrote about the limited domestic circle and influenced Scott in writing the historical novel. Next video will be on the prose writers of the Romantic period. Thank you.